Simon & Schuster Audio presents This Is Assisted Dying, a doctor's story of empowering patients at the end of life, by Dr. Stefanie Green, read by the author.
For my patients, who have each left an indelible mark, and for all the members of CAMAP, upon whose shoulders I stand. Prologue. What if you could decide, at the end of your life, exactly when and where your death would happen? What if instead of dying alone, in the middle of the night, in a hospital bed, you could be at home at a time of your choosing? You could decide who would be in the room with you, holding your hand or embracing you as you left this earth? And what if a doctor could help ensure that your death was comfortable, peaceful, and dignified? What if you could plan a final conversation with everyone you love? You might never look at death the same way again. I knew from the first moment I met him that Ed was an eccentric man. When he opened the door to his apartment, I was struck by the variety of handmade jewelry on his body. A row of bracelets, several necklaces, and multiple earrings. A small statue of the Buddha surrounded by various colored crystals sat on the floor behind him, and a strong smell of incense wafted out of the completely unfurnished space. I had been offering assisted deaths, providing medication and helping people to end their lives for several months by then, and I had met some fascinating individuals, the courageous pioneers and the truly desperate, but still, Ed stood out. I got to know Ed and his story over several months while visiting him in various residences, or sometimes in the hospital in Victoria, British Columbia, Canada. At 68, Ed was proud to say he had never held a job and had lived the life of a free spirit. He told me he had seen the world, chased his dreams, and had few, if any, regrets. Like more than 65% of the people I work with, Ed had terminal metastatic cancer. His cancer had developed over 4 years, and never once had he consented to active medical treatment, avoiding chemotherapy, surgery, and radiation. His disease had progressed as expected and now was causing symptoms he couldn't avoid. Ed's pain was reasonably controlled, but his increasing need for narcotics, his deep fatigue, and his frequent, urgent trips to the restroom were severely limiting his ability to move around independently, which made it all but impossible for him to venture outside. Life confined within four walls was not a life for Ed. He was articulate in his explanation of the loss of meaning in his everyday experience, the dwindling of sand in his hourglass. He was a true believer in reincarnation, he told me, and was eager to move on to his next life. Ed was also the first person to tell me he wanted to die alone. When I arrived on the day of his scheduled death, he was in a small private hospital room, a surprising choice for where he wanted to die, and we chatted for a while first. He seemed ready, eager to proceed, tired of waiting. After a few minutes, he excused himself to go to the washroom and returned wearing a full clown suit, tie-dyed pants and t-shirt, a colorful clown wig, and a red nose. He told me he hadn't been sure if he was going to use the nose or not, but in the end, he decided to go for it. Despite all our previous conversations, I'd never realized Ed was an amateur clown. I asked him why he'd chosen to wear the clown suit on this day, and he told me he wanted to go out laughing. He figured this was his best bet. I called for the nurse, and as Ed was having his IV started, I excused myself to go see his friend Maggie, who he had asked to wait in the quiet sitting area nearby. About 10 years his junior, she was sad but coping. I wanted to explain to her what would be happening even though she wasn't going to be in the room with us. But before I got started, I mentioned that Ed had put on his clown suit. Oh, good, she said. He felt sure that would make him smile. I saw a small, shy grin. You should tell him a joke. I was open to the idea, but at a bit of a loss for content. He helped me through a tough time a while back, Maggie explained. We've known each other over 20 years. He taught me the basics of how to be a clown. She smiled broadly at the memory. We even worked a few events together. I was terrible at it, but it wasn't really about the clowning. It was about the friendship. Then she told me his favorite joke. I headed back into Ed's room where everything was in place. He was resting on top of the bedsheets, quite colorfully laid out. He was ready, he told me, and the nurse confirmed that all was in order from his perspective, too. The nurse, a middle-aged man dressed in hospital greens, was a veteran in his profession, and as he finished packing up his IV supplies, he paused to look me in the eye. These were still early days in assisted dying, and I wasn't sure what might be going on in his mind. Across the bed from him, I replanted my feet, lifted my chin, perhaps only metaphorically, and readied myself for a possible lecture about how he couldn't condone the work I was doing. But the nurse spoke quietly and explained it was the first time he'd been involved in a case of assisted dying. He wanted to thank me for my work. He believed having this option was important, that it was long overdue, and he was glad he could contribute in some way. I exhaled. I suspected he may have witnessed many deaths over the years that he might not have described as good, and his brief, unexpected remarks sparked a feeling in me of relief and being supported. I thanked him for his words and work, and he left Ed and me alone. "Are you sure you're ready?" I asked Ed. "Yes, I'm certainly ready," he replied. He was looking straight up at the ceiling, not nervous, not sad, but not smiling. "All right, then, I will begin." I was standing next to the bed, on Ed's left, with the medications neatly lined up on the bedside table. 8 syringes in all. The middle 2 were quite large and filled with a milky white substance. The bright blue plastic tackle box I carried them in was on the floor next to my foot. I administered the first dose of medication through the IV catheter in his arm. Often around this time, I will guide my patient to a cherished memory, if appropriate. On this occasion, however, I leaned over and spoke close to his ear. I asked, "Ed, why don't cannibals ever eat clowns?" He turned his face toward mine with a big smile, and without missing a beat, he delivered his favorite punchline. "Because they always taste a little funny." We were nose to nose and both grinning from ear to ear, and as he turned his head back to a comfortable position, I heard him chuckle. Then he closed his eyes and fell asleep. Ed's death and my ability to legally assist him was made possible by a Supreme Court of Canada decision known as the Carter decision, which struck down the blanket prohibition of assisted dying and was followed by a change in the law that took place on June 17, 2016. On that day, the Parliament of Canada legalized what it termed medical assistance in dying, or MAID, which allows doctors and uniquely nurse practitioners to assist someone in ending their life under certain specific circumstances. Under the new legislation, patients have a choice of 2 methods of assistance, either a self-administered drink with a healthcare practitioner standing by to make sure all goes smoothly, or much more commonly, medication that is delivered by the clinician through an IV, as I had offered Ed. Participants have to be eligible for government-funded healthcare, essentially Canadian residents or citizens, over 18, capable of making their own healthcare decisions, and suffering from a grievous and irremediable condition. There have since been changes to what this entails, but at the time, for someone to be eligible for MAID, their suffering had to be intolerable, their decline irreversible, and their natural death reasonably foreseeable. This did not mean they were required to have a terminal illness or a prognosis that specified the limited time they had remaining. There was no need to quantify how much longer a patient might live if they didn't receive MAID. It could be days or weeks for some, months or even years for others. It meant only that they were on a trajectory toward a natural death due to their serious and incurable illness. But the person must already be in an advanced state of decline, and they must make the request voluntarily and under no sense of coercion. Assisted dying in some form or another is now available in many countries around the world, although it's known by different names in different jurisdictions. In the United States, the most common term is assisted suicide, or physician-assisted suicide, in which a person can take his or her own life with the doctor providing the medications with which to do so. This term is meant to emphasize the essential element that the death is self-administered. The medication involved exists primarily as a drink, a somewhat foul-tasting liquid mixture of barbiturates. And in 2016, when I began working in the field, this form of assisted dying was legal in the Netherlands, Belgium, Luxembourg, Switzerland, Canada, and 5 American states. Here in Canada, we offer both the self-administered drink and another option, which involves a healthcare professional administering the medications via an intravenous, an IV. Many describe this second option as euthanasia. The term euthanasia originates from the Greek eu, meaning good or well, and thanos, meaning death. The modern understanding and use of the term defined it as the administration of a lethal medication by a healthcare professional at the explicit request of a competent adult with the goal of relieving further pain and suffering. The key difference between assisted suicide and euthanasia, then, is in.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.